identity you would like to prefer, that you are conservationist or wildlife conservationist?
Conservation only came by activism, because you see something which you like and you see that something you like is being killed, so you want to do something to help it. So then people give you a label of conservation or something like that. I have many labels.
You're also a field producer.
I'm also a field producer. These are all labels. The real meat is still snakes and crocodiles.
So tell me about the Mutas Snake Park and Crocodile Park.
The original idea came for the snake park came because I worked in the Miami Serpentarium. You can go on any TL that can say. Miami Serpentarium, I worked for my guru, who was William Hotch. And he was a very great man who had a very strong work ethic, which I tried to copy. And also, I found that coming to India, India is called land of snakes. But people have the wrong attitude about snakes. You know, it's not the right. So I thought maybe I can change the attitude. And besides, having a snake park means I can keep lots of snakes, not at home and as pets, but in a beautiful surrounding. So the forest department in Tamil Nadu gave me land to almost 250 rupees a year in the center of
the city. It was in
1972,
right?
That was 72. You know all the numbers.
So, what about the crocodile
park? Yeah, the crocodile bank, we call it the G Bank, started because at the snake park we got two crocodiles, and within the first year they started moving. We only had half an acre of land for so many snakes and other reptiles, so we thought, okay, we better make something. A separate entity, which we call the Madras Crocodile Bank, a gene bank of crocodiles. So we 14 crocodiles we transferred to this new 8-acre piece of land south of Chennai, city, on the coast of the East Coast. And they started breeding. Within a few years we already had hundreds, and now we have more than 2,000. And we have 18 different species now, which is very exciting, because that means we have, it's a real international gene bank. We have that from most of the parts of the world.
Is this the part of the, that part of the
world? Yeah, that was
the explanation of this part.
It was. The original idea to come here was thanks to something called the International Trade Center in Geneva. So people look at me and say, what are you talking about, crocodile trade? You're supposed to be a conservationist. But I strongly believe in sustainable use of wildlife. And I believe that many species of animals have been saved, and many habitats have been saved by careful utilization of wild species. Careful is the key word. So that's why I was invited to come in 1982 to do a survey in the Kimberley. Yeah, even it's still related to that, because in 1982 I could count only four, I could only see four crocodiles in the whole of Sundarbans. I thought something was wrong here. There's a huge, biggest mangrove area in the world, and you can only see so few crocodiles. Why? And to be honest with you, we're still asking the same question.
So what do you think the reason is?
The original numbers that was given to us by the Forest Department is that thousands of crocodiles were killed in the 1950s for the skin industry, and also because people were anti-crocodile in those days. Now the shift to conservation has happened, and crocodile numbers have not rebounded very fast. In fact, it's very, very slow. One reason people say is because there's too much human presence and too much disturbance. That's maybe part of the reason. But, the real reasons are yet to be found out. That's why Karinam and Rashid's work is very, very important. And it's very important that the Forest Department supports their work, because they are not doing. Forest Department itself is not doing the research that's needed. So the collaboration is very, very essential at this point.
So, what do you see, the reality and possibility in wildlife conservation in Bangladesh?
Yeah, you have a country with a lot of problems, you have a country with extreme pressures, but as in India, in a similar way, you still have lots left. That's the point. And you have the attitudes of people who are quite tolerant about living next to wildlife. I mean, even though there's some elephant conflict in some of the border areas and so on, but, you know, they're not killing off the crops yet, but there's no great move to kill elephants. So that's a wonderful thing that we have in common with India and Bangladesh, that the people are very tolerant. And it's up to us to help make that tolerance okay for their livelihood, for them to survive. They shouldn't get injured by crocodiles or elephants. So we can help with our research.
What do you think, how can we involve more and more the middle class Bangladeshi young people into the wildlife conservation or the conservation as a profession after the...
I think what you're doing is probably one of the biggest ways to do it. It's happening in India now. The educational institutions like NCBS and Indian Institute of Science in Bangalore, they have every year the Students Congress on Conservation Science. And every year there's a meeting there. It's sponsored by the internationally, and we get there as well. So when I first started doing my work in India, there were very, very few young people coming for wildlife work. Simply, one main reason is their parents said, "There's no job for you. It may be interesting as a hobby, but it's not a job." And now it's different. There are jobs available.
One last question. Do you share with us your one of the most best memory?
Best memories are
or the worst.
They're happening every day. But I'm a very lucky guy because I got hired to do work in New Guinea, and I set up a base in the Andaman Islands.
Yeah.
And Andaman I thought, So these are. And it's very exciting and very rewarding to go to a place like that, to meet local tribal people, to interact with them. Those are the most exciting things. Because they don't have education the way we call education, but they have an education from the earth and from the animals. And they taught me more than any professor. I have no degree in science. I never went to college.
Yeah.
I don't know if that's the wrong message to give.
I'll deliver this message. when I come here, one of my friends asked you one question. There is a wrong perception that the anaconda, they gallop the human being. Is there a routine that anaconda is
like
human? Would
you like to watch movies about the fact that pop movies are just they ruin the reputation
in Hollywood.
Yeah, in Hollywood. But in Bollywood they create horrible stories about cobras taking revenge and all, and people believe that nonsense. So I'm afraid that movies, well, it's better to watch the wildlife channels.
That's why I want to. Okay, thank you, sir.
Sure.